once again at an afternoon session. So my name is Deb Fallows. My husband Jim and I have been here all week as part of the festival and enjoyed it tremendously. I'd like to thank the Aspen Writers Foundation and the Aspen Summer Words for making it possible for all of us to be here, and thank you all for showing up and coming once again. It's really our pleasure to be here in Aspen. Just one and a half housekeeping details. There's a party that starts at 6 o'clock, so on your way to picking up your glass of wine, you can stop by the bookstore and buy everyone's books for the book signing. So that takes care of the housekeeping details. I'm delighted to be here with Lisa C. and Yiyun Lee. I feel like I've known both of them for a very long time, although they don't know me. Like most of you, I'm sure you know them from their writing, and it's a funny thing when you've read their books because you feel like you know them and you know go up and start talking to them like they should also know you. I first met Lisa when I read Snowflower and the Secret Fan, and was particularly attracted to her comments about the secret language, Nushu, of the Chinese women in a very remote section of China. I'm a linguist, it's my background, and that's why I'm here. I wrote a book about that called Dreaming in Chinese, but finding that there was this secret language of the Chinese women was fascinating. And Lisa, so ever since I read that, I've been looking online and Googling, trying to find out something about this language, and there's basically nothing to find out, although Lisa told me that there is some obscure PhD thesis out of Canada that talks about it, so I'll do my best to pursue that. And Yiyun Lee, I don't know if I told you this story, but I had a really wonderful moment. You weren't there, but it was about you. Went at Mrs. Dalloway's bookshop in Mrs. Dalloway's garden. It's a bookstore, yes, in Berkeley when I was doing a talk there. And they're very kind people. And at the end, they said, oh, you know, we'd like to give you a book as a thank you. And what would you like? And you know, you kind of demur and say, thank you, I don't know. And she said, I have the perfect book for you, and handed me The Vagrants from Yiyun. So it was a really nice moment. So I'm very, and she was right, delighted to have both of them here. The time for introductions. Now, I think you'd have had to be certainly pretty far out of the valley or even on Mars to not know anything about these two women at the end of this week. They're both extremely prolific writers and have won many, many awards, you know, piled up to the ceiling. And what I'd like to do instead of reciting those again is instead of looking backward to look to the future a little bit, because I also happen to learn that each of them has a new book coming out that they each have just finished. And so we'd all love to hear a little bit about your new book, your new books, if each of you would like to say that.
Okay, I just finished this novel called, it doesn't say very, I mean, I have to say it aloud, called Kinder Than Solitude. It looks a little better on the page. It's coming out in March 2014 from Random House. And the novel, I mean, unlike The Vagrants, which was about 1970s China, the novel is set in contemporary America and China. So it is East meets West in the novel. So it's about this murder mystery, or, you know, half-murder mystery that happened in 1989, right after the Tiananmen Square massacre, the aftermath of Tiananmen Square, and there was this murder, which did not And which did not succeed, I would say that. And so the book is about 21, 22 years later, and the three people who were engaged in the case, and the woman who was supposed to be murdered, and she died 22 years later. So it's 22 years later, present day in America, and all three of them were contemplating about the case and how their life and how China changed in the past 22 years. Yes.
Thank you. Lisa.
Well, I wish I could say mine was done. I have about five more days.
That's done.
I'm at the point where I'm reading 50 pages a day out loud to just catch any final mistakes. So it's called China Dolls, and it's you know, my books are all historical novels, so it's based on the nightclub, Chinese American nightclub era here in this country during the 1930s and 40s. And so I've spent the last couple of years going out and finding performers. And these were people who billed themselves as the Chinese Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, the Chinese Frank Sinatra, the Chinese Houdini, the Chinese fill in the blank. And so I've interviewed, I did get to interview the Chinese Ginger Rogers, 92 years old, who, by the way, is actually Japanese. I interviewed a woman named Mai Tai Singh, 88 years old, this unbelievable woman who cut such a wide swath. I'm sure she slept with every man in Hollywood and then some, but the drink, the Mai Tai, was named for her. So these are really extraordinary people, so amazing because they are not at all your typical idea of a Chinese or even Chinese American woman, because they, you know, even though they're in their 80s and 90s, they kind of talk like old Hollywood broads. So I've had a lot of fun with it, and I'm just a couple days away from sending it in.
That's great. Well, I think we'll, I know we'll all look forward to both of those. So Yiyun anticipated my first question a little bit, but we can go on, I think. I wanted to talk about the blend of Chinese and American influences on your life, for both of you, and on your writing, because you've, well, and I'd like to talk about how those two influences are, how they've led to your evolution as writers. And so Yiyun, probably most of you know, lived in Beijing, lived in China, through the university at Beijing University, and came to the U.S. in 1996, and has been here since then, and is raising a family here. She mentioned one funny thing that she noticed about her own language, and I'd say her own point in being comfortable in America, when she used to say she was going back to China, and then she dropped the back, if I'm right, and said, yes, when she would go to visit in China, it would be go to visit in China, which is, you know, some kind of indication that there's a little pivot point there when you have a different degree of familiarity and are not going back home anymore. Lisa had spent a lot of time in her childhood in Chinatown and was growing up with a lot of Chinese tradition in a very formative time of your year, of your life. But you know, now we're adults, and I know that you've been around on a lot of, seen a lot of America, going around on book tours and just, you know, what normal adults do, and raising a family in America. So I think both of you have these different but similar influences of China, maybe earlier in your past, and America in the forefront now. So I'd like to get a sense of, from each of you, as time moves along, and as perhaps that bigger experience is more in your past, if that's true, how it has affected your writing, or how you might see it will affect your writing as you go forward.
Go ahead. Okay, I'll go first this time. Actually, I find that it becomes an ever greater influence, that I'm not further and further away from it. I get closer and closer to it. And a few years ago, I did two things, sort of, they were simultaneous, which didn't have much to do with writing. One was I curated an exhibition on the history of the Chinese in America. It was the largest exhibit ever on the history of the Chinese in America. It went to the Smithsonian. And at the same time, I wrote a libretto for an LA Opera production of On Gold Mountain. And I think in that time, you know, in those few years, it just, you know, really pulled me deeper into that part of my life. And since then, you know, I've been really involved in a lot of projects that have to do with the preservation of Chinatown and the preservation of certain archives, and trying to find things that other people would throw out, but I think should really be saved, and that that passed, you know. It's true, most of those people who were so important to me as a girl are gone now, but they're very much with me all the time. And the idea that what they went through and what they experienced would disappear forever, I think is really what drives me as a writer.
That's so interesting, because I was actually talking to Lisa the other day. I thought, you know, her experience of China and the Chinese culture and my experience of China and Chinese culture are the opposite. And I would say for me, I grew up in China, but a lot, I mean, my parents' generation, history was taken away from them. For instance, my mother, you know, my mother was born in before communism took over China. And she turned 8 when communism took over China. And I remember she once told me, she said there was only one song from before the communism she could remember, but she could remember one line. And all after that, because of the education and also, I think, propaganda, I think for her, the communist history is her Chinese life. Which actually I turn away from. I think, you know, I very consciously turn away from her memories, or not her memories, but her experience a little bit. Well, I think, again, you know, in China, I think history and culture, again, every day they're sort of like you are preserving the things. Well, we already don't have them. And the history, the archives were already, you know, burned in Cultural Revolution, all the family, you know, books were burned. So, I, you know, it's very interesting. So I started without that. And so I feel that my journey is actually moving westward in the way that whatever I bring with my memory, so my Chinese experience has less to do with, I think, culture now, but more to do with the people. And the everyday people, how they live and what their stories are. So those are the things I think I'm still writing about. But I'm not sure, I don't think I'm moving away from them, but I also, I'm aware these are the people who are moving into 21st century China, and in China, and they are experiencing China in the 21st century. So I'm experiencing this new, I guess, century with them.
Uh-huh. But can I say, though, in The Vagrants, for example,
you
have really captured a very particular moment in time, and through those individual people that you wrote about, it seems to me that you really are preserving the individual experience. It is creating a history that may have, you know, that is in danger of being lost.
Yes, I think that's the, maybe that's the beauty of fiction is, you know, you don't have to have the statement that you're going to do these things. You can do that with storytelling, and I think that's what you're doing too, with storytelling, with interviewing these characters.
Right.
Yes, yes, yes.
But I, you know, but also at that time, it's actually the aftermath, you know, it's, it's, well, it's in the, I guess that is in the, still in the culture.
It's after culture.
But really after.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's, that's a moment that I think now, you know, I'm sure many of you have read various memoirs about the Cultural Revolution. There are so many of them out there, and other novels and films that take place during the Cultural Revolution. But there's very little about the aftermath of it.
Yeah.
And so,
yeah,
you know, you've done that, and you've actually created the, preserve the history of that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
That's just
that's
my opinion.
Well said.
So as I've listened to you both and Sandra during the week, and how much your family heritage has, how much of your life is invested in that, and what an impact the Chineseness has had on you, I must say I'm a little bit envious. And I've been trying to sort through this, because my background is has all of my grandparents were immigrants from Czechoslovakia, from Bohemia, in the early 1900s. And I don't feel anything near the sense of connection that both of you, and I guess especially Lisa, because that's more comparable to my experience, have with China and the impact on me. My dad first spoke Czech as a little kid, not English, and my grandparents, one set of them really never learned English very well, and yet it didn't have the same kind of mark on my life that it has on both of you. So I'm wondering, you know, there's a great literature like this out of India, out of China, and I'm sure out of some other places, but do you think there's something special,
yes,
about China and something that's just so big about the Cultural Revolution that makes that difference? Or did I just kind of miss a lot when I was growing up that I didn't notice my own heritage?
Well, you know, I think for a lot of us, it really depends on who's dominant in your family, your mother or your father, and, you know, which side of the family you have a lot of. You know, my mother's side of the family, they got here in 1640. You know, that they were like, you know, the fourth boat or something. So I don't, and my mother, but today, or when I was growing up, my mother had a mother, a father, and a half-sister, and one cousin. And I had, and my father's side was 400 people, more, you know. I mean, it was just immense. And so that's, you know, that really, my mother's side, there was just wasn't much, you know, it was sort of, it had disappeared, really. It wasn't terribly important. I do remember reading a study many years ago. This guy, it wasn't a study, it was just this, you know, sociologist, anthropologist guy who'd gone out and had done a study about Thanksgiving. And that he could look at anyone's stuffing and know what their family background was.
That's great.
Because it would tell you, and it would be something like, you know, in our family we'd put some makgeolli and water chestnuts and things like that in the stuffing. So you could come to my house and you would think, oh, I know where these people might be from. So maybe somebody in your family was sneaking a little something from Czechoslovakia into the stuffing. Didn't you make those Easter
true.
Eggs?
My grandfather was a baker. You know, there's a lot of that.
And didn't
that
you make those those special Easter eggs or a rutka? Didn't you make rutka?
We did all that, but I could never write about it in the same way that either of you write about, that both of you write about your heritage. And so I guess a slightly different version of that question for you and is the impact of the Cultural Revolution on what drives you?
You know, I would say that's probably not the only thing that drives me. I think that's part of the memory, you know. But like to me, I think, but let me just go back to what you just said about, you know, who comes from where. And I love America. I mean, I love America. That sounds really strange. I love when I go out and ask people where their family comes from and to know, and you know, it's very interesting. Like, for instance, I lived in Iowa for many years, and there's a big group of Czech immigrants coming to Iowa. And my colleagues, their parents' generation still kept every, you know, tradition of Czech tradition. Mm-hmm. And my colleague, and she's a little bit older than I, and she said when she was younger, every child had to learn the accordion. And there was this whole state in accordion contest. Every Czech child had to go, and she won the champion. But I think that tradition stopped with, like, from it stopped with her and her daughter. Mm-hmm. I look at her daughter, and she's a very, you know, American child. And it's very interesting. I think whoever that generation decides to stop that tradition is always interesting to me.
And what about your sons?
I think I am stopping certain traditions for him because I also want him to sort of to grow like an American child. But I have a friend who's Irish immigrant, you know, whose father is Irish immigrant in upper state New York, and she said most Irish children would go learn Irish dancing. But her father made the decision they were not going to go Irish dancing. So they grew up, they became American. So I think, you know, whoever, you know, makes that decision is very interesting to me.
And Lisa, I don't know how old your children are, but how Chinese are they? And how
well they were both have hair sort of like you, you know, very blonde. Mm. And you know, every child is different. You know, I'm just going to go back a generation, two generations behind me first. So my great-grandparents had five children. The oldest one was the, you know, first Chinese son. He had responsibility to the family that none of the other boys had. But nevertheless, he married a white woman. They went to Mexico to get married. But he always stayed with the family. He always ran the family business, but he had no friends in Chinatown. The second son hated the fact that he was Chinese and spent, as soon as he could get out of Chinatown, he got out and he never looked back. He's the evil Uncle Ray. The next one, Benny, he just loved his older brother Ray. Together they went away, and I remember interviewing his daughters, and they said, when they lived in Beverly Hills, and they said, when they were growing up, their parents said to them, never, ever, ever tell anyone you're Chinese, because they would lose their house, they would have to move, they girls would have to leave the school. Then the next one, Eddie, my grandfather, youngest brother, totally pointless person on the face of the earth, really, in Chinese culture. So he stayed with the family. All of his friends were in Chinatown. His whole life was in Chinatown. And then the one girl, no one was going to marry her, no white person was going to marry her. And so she ended up finally, after 8 years, marrying someone who was Chinese, the first person in our family to be married legally in America. And she was the quintessential Chinese daughter-in-law. So there you have, just in one family, different ways that people approach that. So with my sons, I think my older son feels completely disconnected. And his wife is, they're from Iran. And now I have a grandchild who's half Persian and half Mishmash. And I can see that, you know, because that family, they're completely into food like we are, but, you know, that it's going to be really important to them that he have Persian culture. Very important in their family that, you know, so I can see this sort of dual already, you know, he's only a year old, but we're gearing up. my younger son, he spends more time with the Chinese side of the family than I do. And he is completely devoted, you know, and just completely in it. But here's the interesting thing. My older son, who I don't think, if you ask them, what's your background? My younger son would say Chinese, and my older son would say, well, you know, I'm half Jewish and half, I've got a little Irish, and, you know, and he'll go through the whole list, and the Chinese will be at the bottom. But here's the thing. When he was in, went away to college, that first semester, was the first winter, and all of a sudden he got very homesick. And he just was so homesick. And so what he would do, and his dorm had rooms, four girls, four boys, four girls, four boys on the same floor. And he said, I always go over to the girls next door. They have a rice steamer. And the smell makes me feel better. And he would just sit on the bed there and just smell the rice. And he would, so even though he thinks he doesn't have a connection, you know, and I think he presents himself as not having a connection, he definitely has, you know, I think in his deep inside, a very deep
stomach,
connection.
At least.
Yeah, stomach, Chinese stomach.
So I wanted to talk a little bit about translations, which I think we haven't talked too much, at least I haven't heard too much here. I've heard some, when we were in Shanghai, I was talking to some both Western and Chinese women who were translators, and they would, you know, translate into the opposite language, and talking about how really difficult it is to translate something in either direction between English and Chinese, because the literal part of it you can do, but being a really good translator, they explained to me, was an art form to incorporate the sensibility and the references to culture, and maybe even sometimes put in some references or take out some references that would make no sense in what would be a more literal translation. Yiyun, I know you have some things to say about translations of your book, and which I know the answer to, but I also wanted to follow on with the question of if it comes time for you, when you're ready to have your your work translated. And I think also I'd like to say, you told me that there was one story that was translated. I want to know what that is. Would you do it yourself, or would you have somebody else do it, and would you read it? And maybe while you're thinking about that, I would just say to Lisa that a little bit of a different kind of question. I read that your books have been published in 39 different countries, so probably you haven't read their mastermind of the translations of all of those, but particularly in Chinese, which I assume they've been in Chinese. How do you, or do you, monitor the translation or not, or care, or worry about the quality of what it might be, when there it is out there for the world, and it maybe it's not just what you had in mind? So.
I'm so happy you mentioned translation. That's my favorite topic. And I think, you know, I think translation, you know, I benefited from reading Russian novels, of course, translated into Chinese, so I think translators, you know, deserve everything they deserve. I think translations are difficult because there's the translation of language, I mean, the text, and there's also the translation of the situations. And I think the translation of situations is more difficult than the text because, as you said, there are cultural references and there are, you know, political references and all these things. If you look at even just from Chinese to I'll take an example from my work, from English to Chinese. One reason I always hesitate to translate into Chinese is I think because I write for Western audience, I have to do certain explanations. So to give you an example, if I say 1958, I have to say this is the beginning of the three years famine that killed 400,000 people in China. But in Chinese, you cannot do that. You cannot say 1958 is the beginning of the three-year famine because every reader knows that. So you're underestimating your reader's intelligence. Yeah. So I think, you know, that's an example that I don't think you can do direct translation. And so I think what I find interesting because I have worked with many translators and I noticed that different language or translators from different language have different approaches. Like my Swedish translators, I would write the names of the flowers, but I would use their Chinese flower name. Say, you know, like jade something something. Like jade barret is one kind of flower. And she would approach me and she said, can you provide the Latin name of that flower? So I can find the Swedish name for that. And they treat the text, my translators are very, very careful. They treat the text, especially plants and flowers. They always want to know the Latin names. Yeah. And my German translator actually pointed out that I have a mathematical mistake in my novel. It's so very German, she said. She said, according to my calculation, the population in this city is different than what you said. So I had to go back and explain to her how my calculation, you know, came to that number. So I think translation, you know, translators are not only translating, they're also, you know, fact checkers. You know, they do all these things. My Japanese translator is, every time I mention a Chinese song, she would go back to the Chinese website. She would, you know, she would Google Chinese website. She would find exact song and ask me, are you talking about this song? But is this song, you know, did this song exist in 1989? I mean, she's that careful. Mm-hmm. So I feel that's the thing, you know, I think translators really teach me how to write too in that way. Yeah. So, I mean, to answer the second part of your question, I don't think I can translate my own work into Chinese only because I've never read it in Chinese, and I don't think in Chinese. So it's an impossible task. But I would like to monitor the quality of the translation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And is there one of your stories that has been translated into
Chinese? There was a story that I published in the New Yorker called "The Science of Flight." And it's not in any of my book. It's after all my books were published. And I think a Chinese magazine got my permission to translate that story. partly because that story has no politics in it.
Uh-huh.
It's about a Chinese immigrant in Iowa, and I feel safe about that, so I give the permission.
Interesting, and yeah, and just as a footnote, none of your other works have been translated into Chinese officially, correct?
No, and yeah. It's per my choice. Again, yes. I said no to all the offers.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, a couple of things. So first, my German translator for Snowflower and the Secret Fan, you know, same thing, wanted to know what was the particular snowflower, and you know, in anyway, they came up with a name, but even she wrote and said, that is such an ugly name, we can't possibly use it. You know, whatever it was
this
in German.
The German?
The German yeah. Snowflower, you know, uh-huh. It was just so ugly that in German that we just can't use it. So the book has a different title there, and I can't even remember I think they ended up using snowflower and lily. I mean, you know, the actual...
Uh-huh.
English names, uh-huh. Because snowflower in German was just too hideous.
Huh.
So there's that. So, but just a couple things about translations. Snowflower and the Secret Fan was the first book that, you know, obviously had all of those translations, but it was also the first time that I went on an international book tour. And this was, for the first one, it was the Netherlands, Germany, and Poland. And in the Netherlands, everyone asked me, is this your novel of Christian atonement?
Oh,
in Germany, they all asked, is this your feminist manifesto?
Yeah.
And in Poland, they asked, how do you know so much about Poland? Because they thought it was an allegory about Poland, and that the butcher was the main character. So is that a function of the sort of way a country read something, or was it the translation?
Yeah.
Can I just comment
sure.
on that? I think it's very interesting. Again, when you mentioned title, I realized, I mean, every translation of The Vagrants has different titles in different countries. Because many European countries said The Vagrants is such an ugly title.
Huh.
You cannot use The Vagrant. So in Spanish, it's called The Gate to Heaven. Which is terrible. And they just love it.
I guess I didn't read the book.
And then in France, it's A Beautiful Day in Spring, which is also a bad title.
Wow.
But I think, again, the title is so geared towards the market, I think. They really talk about they cannot sell The Vagrants as a title.
Yeah, so it's also a marketing issue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then there's one other thing about translation, which I'm surprised that neither of you brought up, but, you know, Chinese is such a much deeper language, and there are all those layers to it. And so, you know, we'll read a word, well, here we are in Aspen, we'll read a word like mountain, and we, you know, in our minds we see a mountain. But in Chinese, depending on your education, depending on your interests, you might see a mountain. You might think instead about the Song Dynasty artists and how they would create these, you know, great landscapes with one tiny person in there, and you know, it was supposed to make you think of the insignificance of man in the face of great nature. Or you might wonder if there was a great poem and many written about mountains, and you know, did Li Bai write a famous drinking poem by or about a mountain? Was there a battle history, you know, by a mountain? And so depending on what your education is, what your interests mm-hmm. are, you can translate that in so many different ways. And so, you know, you can take, and I think this is one, well, you could take the same poem in Chinese and have give it to 10 translators to translate into English, and you'll get 10 very, very, very different translations depending on the translator's interest
mm-hmm.
and subject, you know, and emotion, you know, and just what their education is. And actually, I think that that's one of the reasons why it's been very difficult for Chinese writers to do well here, is that the translations, but you might have a different opinion about that, but I think they tend to be kind of direct translations as opposed to translations with real depth.
I totally agree with you, because there's this one Chinese writer, actually I always set up my mind, I'm going to translate her myself, because she's my favorite Chinese female writer alive. And I read her translation. She was translated by just a few stories by a New Zealand translator. But the translator is a scholar.
Right.
So he is not a writer. He cannot catch the nuance of the language. And I just felt I was trying to find an agent for her in New York, and I showed the writing, the translation to all the agents, and they just said we could not publish the book based on this translation, which is exactly as you said. You know, I think it does need, you know, people who know both languages really, really well.
And both cultures.
Both cultures, too. Yes.
It makes me worry about translations, actually. And I was thinking about Mo Yen, who won the Nobel Prize for Literature and wrote very politically. I was Googling around trying to find out who judges this, because he writes only in Chinese. But so somebody's got to. Anyway, the Nobel system has a panel of writers in X number of languages. One of it is Chinese. But it's not like there are 30 people reading that work in Chinese. And I assume somebody's translating it. And you just wonder what is going on with both the translation and the original reading, and how many people, not only Chinese, but the Nobel Prizes come out for so many different languages, the power of the translator in the decisions of things like that, or that's like the top of this decision chain of what happens in translations.
I think, you know, one aspect is, you know, Chinese writers are not well translated, so the translation loses a lot of things. But I also wrote a review for The Guardian of Yu Hua's novel. I think some of the English translations actually some of the Chinese novelists benefit from the translations. Because if you read, I always read the Chinese text alongside the English text. Because if you are reading in Chinese and you know this writer is writing for Chinese readers, I think Mo Yan and Yu Hua, their generation, oftentimes they use very cliched language. They're not particular about their language the way I think a writer should be. But in translation, I think the translators are oftentimes very careful. So the English translation reads better.
Oh, gosh.
And so I actually wrote this whole review about, you know, I think Yu Hua's, I have to take it, it's not Yu Hua, it's Su Tong's novel.
Oh, okay.
Sorry,
I
know, sorry, it's Su Tong's River Town. And I think what happens is, you know, when we write fiction, we always talk about, I'm sure you talk about this too, we make familiar things unfamiliar. And we make, you know, familiar things unfamiliar, we make strange things familiar. So those familiarization and defamiliarization, that's what happens when the translator translates Su Tong's novel. Everything so familiar to the readers becomes less familiar. And it becomes really strange and beautiful.
Wow.
And so I actually find that fascinating.
That's really interesting. Let's have a great translator.
I think Albert Gobas.
Yeah.
Yeah,
translated. I think he's the...
Yeah, he translates that now.
So I'd like to ask one more kind of shorter question, maybe, before we open it up to the audience for questions. And this is about reading each other's work. I think for all of us, you know, as your readers, we've found a lot of things that we admire or that surprise us or that particular things we're attracted to for one reason or another. So I wanted to ask you both about when you read each other's work, what comes out at you? What do you marvel at or what do you notice or what do you take away or what stays with you or what do you wish you could do that the other one does?
Okay.
This is a love fest.
Okay. You know, I think there's, when Lisa says, you know, she writes historical novel, you know, I think oftentimes you read historical novels, you know this writer did the research. You know, sometimes the research shows in the books. And I would become really, you know, wary when you can see, you know, this writer has done all this research and she's very eager to put the research into the book. On every page, you can see, you know, she interviewed this person, she did that. I think Lisa's books are not like that. It's really just, in the end, a novel is about a story. It's about the characters. It's not about the research. So I really love what she did about, just the research in the end is the backstage of the novels, and mm-hmm. and the front stage is the story and the characters. I you probably don't know when Wayne did your movie, A Snow Fan.
Yeah, I noticed he did it.
No, I know. when he was doing the script, he actually sent the script to me, and he said, I want you to take a look. And so I said, oh, there are certain things I really did not like. I was very honest with him. Yes.
But he didn't listen.
He didn't. I said, well, you need to, I told him certain things he had to fix. I think I just feel that he didn't get that, the research should not be on the front. The research should just, come back a little bit.
Yeah. Well, I think what I really love about your work is the way how the characters are interconnected. That it's really almost like cosmic jello, that if you push here, something's going to wiggle over there, mm-hmm. and that there isn't anyone, and I think this is actually very Chinese, that no one is just completely alone, that you are in this town or village where it is this connection, and that no matter what one person does something over here, but it's going to have an effect, a ripple out effect. Mm-hmm. And I just think you do that so beautifully and delicately.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm happy to open this up to the audience. I think there are mics around. We've got a lot of questions. Maybe we'll start on this side where the mic is and then kind of sweep over to our left.
Well, you've both traveled with your work and done many readings and probably had many readers, devoted readers come up and talk with you. I'm curious if either one of you remembers a time when someone had resonated with a universal theme in one of your books that it surprised you that person would have resonated. In other words, you thought you were writing more in the vein of the culture you were representing or diving into, but that person found something very universal in the story, and did it surprise you? Does that make sense as a question?
Well, I don't mean to sound immodest, but I thought all these stories are supposed to be universal. that emotions are universal. Relationships are universal. That's why we read books. I mean, you open a book, you step into another time, another culture, but what you connect to are the characters, real or imagined. And you think about your own life, you think about, the human condition. That's what a really great novel is supposed to do. Even a mediocre novel is supposed to do that.
Yes, just to follow up on that, I do have incidents like that. My first story was published very early on in my career. I published a story in The New Yorker. It's about an older Chinese woman, taking care of a young boy, and she loved this young boy so much. And this was in Iowa City, in Iowa, and two older Caucasian women, and they came to me. They said, oh, we were competing, between ourselves. We were discussing who among ourselves would be that woman in your story. And that is very confirming to me.
Yes. Thank you. More? You can probably see better than I can.
Gosh, gee. There's a couple of things I'd like you two to respond to, and if you like it. I was born in China and came over when I was three. And about five, my father gave me the instruction, assimilate as best you can, but watch your back, because if political ties change, you could end up in a concentration camp. And so there was this dissonance of who am I willing to risk to be, Chinese or American. And I think what I see in both of you is you've got this lovely integration, you might say, of your culture, of more than one culture. But I guess the question is too, you know, did in your own ways, was there ever a point of dissonance in terms of what you identified with?
Is there, in your Chinese and Americanness, is there a tension between the two of them?
Is that what you're asking? That's not what you're asking. You're asking, was there a moment that we had a point of dissonance?
A conflict
yeah.
About the our background.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. No, I'm not modest. No, I don't feel conflicts. Partly is, you know, I just feel very comfortable being myself, and I feel that, you know, I think in Chinese and in English, they're both the same. So you don't find, you know, things to trouble yourself. And I don't feel conflict between my Chineseness and my American. I can't even call myself American, but I don't feel that conflict because I don't feel that's what I'm writing about, because I'm writing about, you know, people, and it doesn't matter if they're Chinese or American.
Yeah, I talked about this, I think it was yesterday, that, you know, my father, I think, went through a long period of feeling very disconnected and had a lot of conflict. And my cousin who's, I don't know if she's actually my cousin, but she's between my father and me. So she's, you know, 10 years younger than my father, 10 years older than I am. And I think she also did. But, you know, I have I'm in a sort of different situation because of how I look, right? Because I'm never going to have that someone coming up to me and saying, you look different, or you sound different, or, you know, I mean, it did in the sense that when I was a little girl, recently I met someone at a book event who, his mother, Margaret, ran the International Grocery on Spring Street in Chinatown, and this guy grew up to be the first Chinese-American fire captain. And he came to an event, and he said, you know, we all knew who you were. You were the little Lo Fan Nuer, the little white ghost girl. And, you know, we knew you belonged, but come on, you know, you were like a white ghost girl. So I guess there maybe I did have some of that, but I never felt dissonance about it.
Yes, there's a question over here.
I've been in a position to professionally counsel families who've adopted children from foreign countries. And the most frequently asked question of a lot of these families is, how do we introduce their original culture to them? How important might that be? The gypsies have a saying, don't ever try to jump your own shadow. And I've listened to that carefully, and I've been really surprised by the number of young people who are now in their teenage years who desperately want to know more about their original culture and want to rather immerse themselves in it. So how would you respond to that question, knowing what you do, from a Chinese adoptee who's been raised in the United States?
Oh, we can both answer. Who wants to go first?
Yes. You can go first.
Okay, so I actually have spoken a lot and done a lot with adoptee groups, Chinese American adoptee groups, especially families with children from China, FCC. And I've done stuff with them all over the country. And here's the really interesting thing. For every girl who wants to know, there are another one or two who don't have any connection and no interest whatsoever. One isn't right and one isn't wrong. And some of it is, you know, some families, they really have worked hard to take their daughters, you know, to Chinese school and to New Year's celebrations and all of that kind of stuff. And the girls are like, oh, please, I don't care. I'm an American. Mm-hmm. see, because they see themselves as American. And then I know a lot of families that have taken, you know, now that their daughters are older, because these girls are really growing up now, have taken their daughters back to China. And, you know, it may seem like a good idea on the surface, and then they get there and these, you know, a lot of families, the girls are really just shocked and want to get on the plane and go home. And some are like, oh, this is great, I want to come and study here. So, you know, it's a whole range of you know, it's as varied as every family can be.
Yeah, just to add on to that, I mean, I, you know, even just look at my own children, and I have two boys, and I mean, they are very American, and I don't doubt one day they would start, you know, they will start become more interested in China. But at this moment, they're not ready. I'm not going to push them. I actually put my older son into Chinese school for one day, and he was so unhappy. He said the Chinese teacher came and squeezed his face like this, said, say this, and he just couldn't do it. And he's very American that way. So I feel that before they're ready, I'm not going to push them to do anything, but I think they have to take their time.
We've got a couple questions over here. Thank you.
This question is for you. You mentioned, Yiyun, I'm sorry. You mentioned that the Cultural Revolution destroyed all the archives, and I think in one of the earlier panels, somebody mentioned that the communists are introducing Confucianism back into China. And 2 years ago, we went to China with Yale in China to teach in a school for a couple of weeks, and some parent was so happy. He wrote a beautiful verse and wrote it on rice paper. So maybe some of it still stayed, the heritage of verse writing and painting and whatever.
Right. No, I should revise. I don't mean that all the culture was destroyed. What I meant was more the history. So what happened, say, in 50s? What happened in 60s? These things. To give you an example, the vagrants was based on a real case in China when this young woman, you know, was executed, and I did a lot of research, but there was just nothing because all the research, all the documents were destroyed. Some of the documents actually about another young woman, I think some of the documents were shipped outside to the, were donated to Stanford Library, which, you know, was a great thing because those things would stay. And if those documents stay in China, you don't know what's going to happen to them. No, I do notice that I think there's this revival of Chinese culture, interest in the traditional culture in China.
But there are things like when I went to my home village and I wanted to go to the Family Association Temple, so everybody, you know, the people who have died, they all have these little plaque things, and they'd all been all destroyed. So the entire history of that village, of every family in that village, had been destroyed. Mm-hmm. And there's no way to replace that. And if you've been to China and you go to various temples around the country, some of them have been, you know, just the heads chopped off, the statues, you know, some of them burned, you know, all kinds, all levels of destruction. And now there's some places where they're trying to restore mm-hmm. things, and, you know, some were preserved. I think one reason why people still to this day, it's just one reason, but still to this day have a great affection for Zhou Enlai was that he would sometimes personally send people, or he himself would go to protect a particular set of temples, and those are still there, you know. But the things that have been destroyed, certain kinds of things, they can't ever come back.
Family documents.
Yeah, family documents.
Yeah, my father's side, the whole like generation after generation of documents, they were all burned.
Ancestral tablets. That's the word I was looking for.
Ancestral tablets. Yeah. And my mother said they burned every single photo before communism took over China. So the whole family album was gone.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question, and there's one more hand, so as far as I can see.
I was just wondering if any of your books were translated also in non-European languages. I'm thinking like particularly in other Asian countries, in India or Arabic countries, or because if it is not published in some of those languages, it is only attractive to the educated people and the elite of the country.
Now, my books are translated into Korean, Japanese, and you know, in I think Arabs and a lot of different languages, Hebrew, and which I mean, the only interesting thing is the Vietnamese publisher actually offered to translate, and then they withdrew their offer because they said if they publish this book, they would anger Chinese government. Which to me is very interesting.
Wow.
And I find that fascinating. I said, okay, fine.
Yeah, same here. I have Japan, Vietnam, Korea, Indonesia, a bunch of countries in there. I mean, you know, it adds up. But I think that's really important. And you know, well, we're done.
Yes.
So I would like to thank Lisa and Yiyun very much for being here, and particularly for speaking in such a personal and honest way, which is a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.